It's not
straight.
Okay, let's try to figure this out.
Try now.
Hold for a second, let's see. But that means this side has to be lifted up more. Or this side has to be lifted up. This side is
it should be like this.
It's all in the positioning of the arms here. Introduction or something?
Okay, introduction. Send me your Zoom. Send me the Zoom thing. To my WhatsApp.
How do we get out of this? Exit what? Okay. Are we ready? I'm ready. Say the first one. The first start. Okay, so we started. Okay. Okay, shalom ubracha, everybody. Shabbat tov. Nice to see all the beautiful people, the new people, Bezat Hashem. So while reading, Bezat Hashem, we're going to go into introductory teachings as a follow-up for those who heard already the shir in Sada Shlishit. That if you weren't there, it's okay, because it's new ideas. And we're going through all these introductions, we'll then go to show how this is the main key for chinuch, education of children, raising children and family, okay? We're going to start off first with another story, funny story, of the two holy brothers. And by the way, it's nice to tell stories of tzaddikim on Shabbat, so we have also part of Melav Malka telling stories of tzaddikim. Rav Elimelech of Lizhensk and his older brother, Rav Zushav Anapoli, was the time that they went on a self-imposed exile, Galut, and they went incognito, unrecognizable, into various villages, various cities. And they did whatever they did, and they went dressed like regular people, so nobody knew they were big tzaddikim. They were rabbis, they were big tzaddikim, they were famous, but they went dressed up differently so no one could recognize them. They came to a certain village, where in that village there was a curfew. Anybody out on the streets after 8 p.m. would be arrested, put in jail, even though they were innocent, until the morning. In the morning, when they would inquire who they are, and they see their documents and passports, whatever, ID, they would let them out, okay? So, Rav Zusha and Rabbi Melech, they arrived about 10 minutes before 8, and they didn't have enough time to set up their lodgings and everything. They're on the street, it's 8 p.m., and they got arrested, and they were put into the jail cell, and the jail cell in that village was set out that, second please, was set up that all the mattresses were around the room, and in the middle was the toilet, the bathroom, to relieve themselves, okay? So around the room were all these very sad Jews and non-Jews, very sad and broken, okay? And in the middle was this restroom that they relieved themselves, and Rav Elimelech was very sad. So Rav Zusha was always the happy brother. He said to his brother, why are you so sad? So he said, what do you want? I can't daven Arvit. I can't do Kriyat Shema of Arvit. How am I supposed to be happy now? I can't daven. I can't learn Torah the smell of the bathroom. It's forbidden. No Torah, no nothing. So if Zusha hinted to him the halacha, you can't say explicitly, so he hinted in the halacha that says like this, that when you're in a situation where you can't daven and can't say Kriyat Shema, for example, in this scenario, where you're exposed to a washroom, so you can't say any brachot, so what you do is you say in your heart, Hashem, I want to do your will, but I can't because of the scenario and the situation, so please let it, Hashem, be considered as if I did the mitzvah, and you are credited as if, keilu, you did the mitzvah. So Rav Zusha told his brother, my dear brother, you're such a perfect tzaddik your whole life. You always did things perfectly, perfectly, perfectly. Now's your opportunity to do the mitzvah like this. You never did this mitzvah this way, of being in a situation that you can't. So, and you're going to miss Kriyat Shema and miss the Shemona Esrei. Huh? Keep it short, fine. But you're going to be in this situation. You were never in this situation. Be happy. So he got him so excited. He started dancing with him, his brother, and all the people in the jail cell. All the goyim and the Jews there, the murderers, the non-murderers, whatever. They saw these two brothers dancing like that. So they saw that everyone's looking at them really weird. So Rav Zusha, they took everybody's hands and they started dancing in a big circle around the toilet. So the warden of the jail cell, he heard this noise of all this singing and dancing. He said, what's the noise here? He said, it's because of the toilet. He said, oh, really? So he went in, he took out the toilet seat. So Rav Zusha told me, now you can dive in. Now you can dive in. Now is the perfect time. What's the point of the story? Like we spoke about Sada Shlishit, Simcha is not just the means, it's the solution. It's the solution. They had a positive attitude and Hashem took them out of it. He was able to dive in, able to Kriyat Shema. This is what we said earlier, that ki besimcha tetzeu, with Simcha, you get out. You're stuck in a situation, it's expected that you do the right thing. What's the right thing is to be happy in that situation. All right, but it's hard for me to be happy. So we said, if you are accustomed to working on the attribute of simcha day in, day out, you eat with simcha, you drink with simcha, you think about it, you dive in, you learn. So when you're faced with such a scenario like this, such a situation like this, by reflex, you go to simcha. You're able to go to it, and simcha is the opening. Because like we said, it guides you, number one, if you have to make a decision, to make the right decision. Number two, Hashem in his compassion, now that you're on his page, because you have the joy, he sends you the right situation that solves it, B'ezrat Hashem. That's how powerful it is. That's how powerful it is. The Zohar, Parashat Bereshit, at the end of Parashat Bereshit, brings down something pretty scary. Okay? The Zohar says on the Pasuk about the generation of the flood and Hashem's pain of how blemished the generation of the flood was, ki ishchit kol basar et darko al haaretz. They went very far in immorality, in theft, incest, everything they went, okay? So the Pasuk says there, vayitatzev el libo. And Hashem, I mean, how we translate it is, and Hashem was saddened in his heart. Vayitatzev el libo, okay? So the Zohar says a few things. Number one, it asks on the grammar of this pasuk. It says, number one, vayit atzev, and not vaye atzev. What's the difference? Vayit atzev is the heart, elibo, the heart is saddened within itself. The sadness is coming from within the heart. That's vayit atzev, as opposed to vaye atzev, which is A, making B sad. Okay? Vayit atzev is more serious. The heart itself, the heart of Hashem, which the Zohar says is the seat of Bina. Bina is Hashem's level of understanding. The sadness hits the sphira, the attribute, the energy of Hashem's Bina. So that's the case. Why do you say El Libo? It should say Vayit Atzev Be Libo. And this heart was saddened in it, in the heart, Be Libo. So why do you say now El Libo? As if to say you're going from A to B, but you just said Vayit Atzev. If you want to say if I'm going from A to B, the Pasuk should read, Vaye atzev el libo, or Vayit atzev ben libo. What's this two opposites of Vayit atzev el libo? So the Zohar says, there's another level of Hashem that's also called the heart, and that's Malchut. The Sphira, the level of Hashem's Malchut, is also called the heart. So the Zohar says that the atzvut, the sadness that Hashem was saddened, hit both the level of Bina and the level of Malchut. What does that mean? The Zohar elaborates and expands the idea. The Zohar says that you have people who who sin and sin and sin, and every time they fall and crack and everything, they want to do tshuva, they start again. So Hashem gives them another chance. And again, they crack up, they fall, they break, and they say, Hashem, chatati, aviti, bashati, I want to come back. And again, Hashem gives another chance. And it goes on this vicious cycle again, again, and again, 100 times, 1,000 times, 10,000 times, until kivyachol, Hashem's level of malchut says, that's it. How many times? Vicious cycle. You're not changing. You're not advancing. You're even worse off than you were before. You keep on saying you want to do tshuva, come back. You keep on falling. You keep on falling again and back. Ping, pong, ping, pong, ping, pong. Enough. We can't give you any more chances. And the person is saying, but give me another chance. Nothing stands in front of tshuva. The sages teach, the Gemara teaches, in davar omed b'fina tshuva, zekoya kola, all the masachim, it opens up. You know, give me another chance. So kivyachol, malchut, Hashem's malchut, closes the door, but malchut says, we're now going to take your case to a higher court, the level of bina. So now a person now is elevated to bina, which is the Zohar says, the root of tshuva. That's where tshuva, the root of tshuva emanates from there. And a person's tshuva goes up to that level, okay? So now we start again. He falls and he asks for another chance and they give him another chance. He asks for a chance, he gives another chance, and it goes on and on and on until even by bina, kivyachol, there's an X. That's it. No more chances. And there's no more than this. There's only malchut and bina for tshuva. The source of tshuva is in bina. So a person has an X and malchut and has an X in bina. So there's a situation where tshuva will no longer help. The Zohar says, where do we see that? In the words of the next pasuk. Vayinachem Hashem al hara'ah. So the Zohar uses one of the two interpretations of Rashi on the pasuk. Rashi and the Zohar say, Vayinachem is milashon, to receive condolences, consolation. So Hashem, Vayinachem Hashem al hara'ah, Hashem received consolation for the bad they did. What consolation? That now Hashem allows Bina and Malchut together to execute judgment against this person. They say, time up. So that now, what does that mean? The person now comes before Hashem. Hashem, give me another chance. After everything I've done, Hashem says, I already shatiti kostan chumin alecha. I already took the consolation by allowing the judgment against you, and your prayers and your tshuva won't help anymore. The Zohar says this, okay? This, Rabbeinu, in lesson 24, he calls this tokpa dedina. Tokpa hadin is when a person has major dinim against him because they've given a person so many chances and he knows that, but there reaches a limit. On falling again and again and again, it's not moving. So a person reaches tokef adin, which means, yes, there's a point where it's hopeless and yush, and at this point, we can't help you anymore. From heaven comes Rabbeinu, Rabbi Nachman, and he says, even in such a scenario, there is an opening that bypasses even Bina. And that's the attribute of Simcha. Simcha, he teaches, Simchat HaMitzvah can bypass even the worst scenario. Let's give an example. A person now has been sentenced to death, okay? So he has a death sentence, and as is customary in the world, they tell the person before he dies, do you have a last request? The person says, yes. I want you to bring in front of me all the generals and officials who signed my case to be killed, to be executed. I want you to bring them in front of me. And for 1 hour, I want to tell them jokes. Okay? They bring their generals, the officials, and everything. And he's telling them jokes and jokes and jokes. At the end of the hour, they're all on the floor cracking up. Okay? They're flipping out. And they say, you know, we can't kill such a guy. We need him. We need comedians like this. We need people to make us laugh like this. So they give him another chance. They sign him off. Go. It's okay.